Where do ideas come from? How do plants turn sunlight into energy? What actually makes these cars go? And why does this rock look the way it does? The answer to all of those questions is chemistry.
The Earth and Stuff. The Earth and Stuff about the Earth and Stuff. The Earth and Stuff about the Earth and Stuff. The Earth and Stuff about the Earth and other things.
Okay, peeps. We gotta do something that nobody wants to do, including me, and that's review some basic chemistry. Now, this is mostly stuff you should have learned in high school, or maybe you didn't yet learn in high school. Are there any pre-high school peeps watching this? Comment below. If you think you're good at basic chemistry, or you just don't care or don't want to see this, maybe skip this video, but you might not fully understand the next video next week if you do. So, you know, you do you, but I hope you stick around and let's just quickly review some stuff so that going forward we all are on the same page. You've all almost certainly seen this, the periodic table. In it, elements are organized by their atomic number, which is given by the number of protons an atom of that element has. Recall that an element is a substance that cannot be broken down into simpler substances, chemically or physically. An atom is the smallest unit of matter that retains the essential properties of an element. You could also say that elements in the periodic table are organized by their chemical properties. For example, the elements on the far right of the table are called noble gases. They are colorless, odorless gases and are fairly non-reactive. On the other side of the table are alkali metals, which are all shiny, soft, and highly reactive solids. Atoms have a nucleus, in which most of the mass of the atom resides. The nucleus contains protons and neutrons. Protons and neutrons have the same mass. Now it turns out protons and neutrons are made up of smaller particles too, called quarks and snipes or whatever, but we don't need to cover that for the purposes of this course. Protons have a positive charge, and neutrons a neutral charge. The number of protons is what defines an element. Here, with two protons, we have helium. Even if we took away one or both neutrons, this atom would still be helium. We call these different kinds of heliums isotopes. Most atoms have multiple isotopes. Despite the difference in the number of neutrons and mass, isotopes of an element behave identically. This is because the chemical behavior is based almost entirely on the electronic structure and charge balances, and neutrons don't have a charge. We name these isotopes based on the total number of protons and neutrons contained in the nucleus. This number is called the mass number. For example, oxygen has three isotopes called oxygen 16, oxygen 17, and oxygen 18. In the periodic table, the listed mass is for the most common isotope, in oxygen's case, oxygen 16. It might seem obvious, but the mass of an atom is directly proportional to its size. Some isotopes are stable while others are not. For example, carbon 12 is stable, and so is 13, but carbon 14 is radioactive. The specifics of radioactivity are discussed in greater detail in another lesson. Around the nucleus of an atom orbit electrons. Electrons have a negative charge. Opposite charges attract, meaning that the electrons are attracted to the protons in the nucleus and repelled by other electrons. How electrons orbit the nucleus is actually kind of complicated, and we don't really care that much for the purposes of this course. Just know that electrons are organized around an atom into shells, with the outermost shell is full of electrons called valence electrons, and they are where the action is. An atom that has the same number of electrons as protons has a neutral charge. An atom with less electrons than protons has a positive charge and is called a cation. An atom with more electrons than protons is negatively charged and called an anion. Remember that opposite charges attract. A cation is inherently attracted to an anion, and that attraction can lead to a chemical bond. There are two broad types of chemical bonds. Strong bonds and weak bonds. Strong bonds involve the transfer or sharing of electrons between atoms and are held together by intramolecular forces or forces within the molecule. Recall that a molecule is a group of atoms bonded together. In covalent bonding, two or more atoms share pairs of electrons between them. The electrons in covalent bonds orbit all the atoms involved in the bond. Covalent bonds are held together in a sort of tug of war over electrons between atoms. Each atom wants the electrons for itself, but doesn't have a strong enough electronegativity to take them. Electronegativity is the power of an atom to attract electrons to itself. In ionic bonding, atoms with considerably different electronegativity either give or receive one or more electrons. The electrons are transferred, and they orbit the atom they are transferred to. The bond is held together by the electrostatic attraction between the atoms. The specific type of bond and the charges involved contribute directly to the chemical and physical properties of the molecule, and molecules often have more than one type of bond. Bonds between molecules are considered weak bonds, and they're held together by intermolecular forces, or forces outside the molecule. There are a variety of weak bonds, in which we won't discuss here. There are also metallic bonds, which are unique to metals, and allow electrons to flow freely between atoms. Chemical bonding could be its own course, so if you want more information, check out the resources in the description below. For our purposes, we'll use General Chemistry 101 nomenclature to describe atoms, molecules, and sometimes reactions between molecules. Here, an individual atom is represented by its English abbreviation, found in the periodic table. Individual atoms can also have their charges next to them. For example, Mg2+ is a magnesium atom with a positive charge of 2. Superscripts denote charges, while subscripts denote the number of atoms. Charges are only usually shown when relevant to the point, and are often left off in chemical formulas. A molecule or compound can be called by its chemical name, but can also be described by its chemical formula. This style of nomenclature can be useful in describing chemical reactions. For example, this is a balanced chemical equation for photosynthesis. Carbon dioxide and water, with the help from the sun, are converted biologically into glucose and oxygen gas. We won't see or use these kinds of chemical equations very often in this course, but you should at least be able to understand what they mean. We can also represent compounds as 3D structures, with each atom being represented by a sphere. You will see a lot of this in the next lesson when we introduce minerals. Though difficult to visualize, it's important to understand the physical structure of the compounds we're discussing, to understand how and why they behave the way they do. So there you have it, a very broad and basic review of basic chemistry. Hopefully that covered all the bases, and hopefully it was just a review for you. If it wasn't, holy cow. Please watch it again, or go look at the resources down in the description below this video, and hopefully you can catch up, because the next episode in this series is going to be talking about minerals, and we're going to be using some chemistry to describe these minerals. Thanks for watching, peeps. See you next week.